Hello, welcome to Watchman Privacy. I'm Gabriel Custodiat. All of my stuff is at watchmanprivacy.com. You'll find my helpful books and video courses, links to my social media accounts, donation links for Monero. All of this supports me, which is important because I take no sponsors. That's right, no sponsors. So around every 15 episodes, please consider giving back. Your contributions determine the future of this show. Thank you. I'm very pleased to be joined by Max Tannehill. And Max is somebody who is involved in all kinds of the Bitcoin and Monero communities on Telegram, on Twitter. He's a guy who is in the trenches. He knows a lot, and I'm very pleased to speak to him. Max, welcome to the show. How are you doing?
Oh, very well, Gabriel. Thanks ever so much for having me. Much appreciated, and certainly feel standing with some very kind of esteemed guests on your show. So very honored to be here. Thank you.
You have... There's very little on you out there in the world, so maybe you could just tell people. By the way, this episode, we're going to cover Bitcoin privacy, we're going to cover Monero, and some other financial privacy questions. And so maybe you could just, Max, give us a sense of your background. What do people need to know about you?
So, yeah, I don't kind of really kind of advertise too much on Twitter is what I'm about. I'm more there just to, you know, typically have an argument and a good discussion and a laugh. But yeah, in terms of kind of, you know, it's certainly no secret. I spent the beginning of my career in financial services after dropping out of British Army officer training and not really knowing what to do, and found myself after leaving London in Singapore, which seemed to be a good spot to be in terms of opportunities, and really kind of was in kind of the traditional financial space, working at, you know, private banks, institutional brokers, doing systems integration, you know, order management, trade management systems, that type of thing. I got into Bitcoin probably reading it about it in 2014. And funnily enough, I kind of was looking recently, I actually made my first transaction in 2015, you know, buying some Bitcoin, and then, you know, as is often the case for a lot of people, then selling it soon after and wishing you hadn't. But, you know, what got me into the space was, you know, hearing some early podcasts, Antonopoulos on Rogan, reading about how Snowden had used it. There was a kind of quite a big aspect there that I'd got into, but I never really expected to work in the space at all. But a couple of years ago, I did take a role with BitGo as a solutions engineer. So it's kind of a pre-sales solutions, you know, doing API integration, that type of work. So, you know, some crossover with my traditional financial background, but obviously using a lot of the knowledge I picked up and had to learn from scratch again with kind of wallets and nodes and all that kind of good stuff that comes from being involved in Bitcoin and the rest of the crypto space. I'm no longer at BitGo, working at another blockchain company at the moment. I just don't tend to advertise it because I don't speak certainly on their behalf. But again, you know, no real big secret there. And it's been a kind of, yeah, quite an interesting experience, having been outside the space as very much an observer and then kind of seeing it from the inside a bit more later.
Maybe I'm interpreting a little bit too much here, but you started off in traditional finance. You moved to kind of the hardcore side of financial privacy with Bitcoin and Monero and such. I almost imagine kind of a road to Damascus conversion where you saw the belly of the beast and then you kind of don't necessarily want anything to do with that anymore. Maybe you could just paint a snapshot of just the sheer lack of privacy in traditional finance, especially these days. You know, how bad a portrait can you paint of that?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I suppose, how can I put it? You know, I didn't come from traditional finance and look at the kind of crypto space and necessarily see it as some huge replacement. Although that's very, you know, very common, I think, belief system held by a lot of people. I see it as an alternative. In an ideal world, if it was Ancapistan, I would have no government to report to. I could, you know, conduct all my transactions voluntarily. But there's a pragmatic side to me. I could call it weak as well, I suppose. We often interact in kind of the meat space in that kind of the fiat regime. And so I'm kind of quite used to dealing with that, and I'll make use of it what I can. And so for me, Bitcoin and some of the other kind of crypto tools out there are just that, really. They're tools that I like to be able to be the master of. And, you know, there may be periods of time where I'll use them more than traditional tools, and a period of time where maybe I might end up having to use them. And I certainly want the mastery in them to be able to do that. But it's not something I've been forced to, possibly because of my own privilege, been had to rely on them, and to the extent where I have to, say, you know, live day by day on them. But to answer kind of specific question on, like, kind of the privacy issues and the traditional financial system. Funnily enough, actually, the traditional financial system's pretty good when it comes to a lot of the privacy that most people care about. Obviously, it's poor if you're worried about keeping your transactions hidden from the government, as you're KYCing with pretty much every service out there, and there's an awful lot of reporting that goes back to the government. But one of the things that you get out of traditional financial systems is a lot of privacy from your peers. You know, if I'm paying for beers in a pub, if I pull out my, you know, cash or even a debit or a credit card, no one else is going to see my bank balance or they're going to see my transactional history. It's pretty unusual, for example, to find people flexing with showing their bank balance to you on their app or anything like that, which I think we can all agree is fairly common in the crypto space when we look at kind of how NFTs are being used and also how carefree people are. With addresses and doing transactions publicly as well. So, you know, in many ways, actually, the traditional financial space is pretty good in that respect. Where it's terrible for, obviously, is censorship resistance. I'm sure all of us have dealt with bank payment failures going through. You know, I had an old Coinbase account closed when I moved coins from there to local Bitcoins. And actually, in some cases, you know, my kind of first dealing with financial censorship was actually, you know, finally moving into crypto and then trying to, you know, merge those worlds and then realizing actually how censored the traditional financial space was.
You're living in Singapore. You have lived in London in the past. These are two major cities which themselves have various privacy invasions. Just curious your thoughts of some of these global cities these days. You know, Dubai is another one. If you have any thoughts on what kind of privacy problems that they present.
Singapore gets a fairly, well, quite correctly, tough rap for kind of privacy and surveillance. The media is quite kind of restricted here in comparison to some Western countries. And of course, you've got this kind of whole CCTV issue, which really was probably pioneered in many ways in London with the justification of the IRA bombings there. So quite honestly, it's something I've actually quite scarily grown up with and probably been used to. And it's kind of almost taken a re-education of myself to find less comfort in that kind of, you know, living in amongst a kind of constant surveillance. So I think it's pretty terrible, you know, on a city basis. And I think that really came to a head during COVID, where Singapore was particularly problematic. And I've spoken about this before with Seth, you know, just how kind of bad Singapore got with acquiring identification to get into restaurants, proof of vaccination, etc. And, you know, things are kind of a lot better now. You know, all of that kind of regime has receded and it's kind of largely back to normal. But it was definitely an unnerving time because even for someone like me with citizenship in the UK and permanent residency in Singapore, ostensibly I kind of thought that prior to anything like that happening, I would have had the flexibility to move jurisdictions fairly easily. But when push comes to shove, you actually realize your jurisdictional flexibility isn't that high. If you're, you know, if you're a waged employee, you know, you can do remote work, but time zones come into it. And you've got kind of, you know, if you're doing a kind of, you know, a white market job, you've got tax regimes to kind of think about. And of course, during COVID, there were the actual travel restrictions. So, you know, there was a lot of effort required to deal with that. I think the trajectory is looking worse. I think, you know, we'll kind of get a recovery of all that over again. I would just say, though, is that I've still got some faith that there'll be pushback in different areas. And ultimately, I think that you as an individual kind of have to rely on like the online freedoms that you have to make up for where you might lack some of the physical freedoms. So, for example, you know, if you feel you're targeted with your own privacy around transactions, you can use online digital cash. And if you're concerned about, you know, your political views or saying something there, you know, we are still kind of blessed with products out there that we can use that anonymize us and can, you know, allow us to post pseudonymously. And I think that's just going to be, you know, an increasing kind of state of affairs we'll have to get used to until, of course, you're able to kind of exercise kind of complete jurisdictional flexibility and move and actually move to a country that offers you all the freedoms that you wish. But until then, you're probably, for a lot of us, you're making just tough decisions with to play with what you've got, play your hand that you've been dealt.
You had a little bit ago a company called Mamushi. Maybe you could tell us about that and any lessons learned from that.
Yeah, sure. So Mamushi really kind of started out of kind of initial kind of boredom because I couldn't really do much when I was in Singapore. So I was looking for something to do. So I'd already been involved in the Samurai community particularly, which is, for sure a lot of your listeners will know, is a Bitcoin app that's available on Android. And I had always been a kind of long-suffering iOS user, really refused to use Android for ages because I kind of hated the whole Google Play Store and the spyware that came with that. And what kind of became clear to me was that although there were solutions out there for kind of flashing non-Google Android software into your phone, it wasn't necessarily that easy to do. It wasn't necessarily that easy to acquire the hardware, depending on kind of where you were. And so I started a company to really just kind of do a kind of distribution of those phones. Without getting into too much detail, I started off with a company called Copperhead, which was a source available operating system. And my intention was actually to see how to start a business and to try out kind of selling these kind of phones to what I kind of expected to be an enterprise demand for it. There was some demand, and that deal fell through for reasons I described on the website. And then after that, I kind of moved to open source software, which was a kind of very organic move, you know, something that a lot of the kind of community had already started doing. It was a really fun business to operate. You know, I did take some banking payments, but pretty much all the transactions were in Bitcoin or Monero. It was fun operating a web store. I had help in the US and Europe for the acquisition of devices, the flashing of them, and then the distribution within those regions. So that made the logistics a lot easier. Whilst I managed the kind of the ordering on the website and doing some of the distribution myself. And it was just a really kind of good fun side gig to do, kind of way of like acquiring some crypto on the side, you know, having fun helping people out on products that, you know, that all of us in the kind of the team had known innately from having tried out. I wound that down really just kind of, I got a bit too busy, and I think there was a bit of a less of a demand for these devices for a couple of reasons. The Graphene OS Android distribution system got easier and easier to install, so I think the friction overhead was less of a problem for users. And the Calyx OS operating system actually expanded to more devices, which made it a lot more approachable for a lot of users that couldn't necessarily get hold of Google Pixel devices, kind of hardware, and they could use other phones and move ahead to that. Busy with my a new role at the time anyway, and kind of quite happy to stop doing that side gig as well. But I think the other thing I would kind of say as well is, and this is a big warning for anyone else looking to start a business, is don't take the accounting aspect lightly. It was definitely the worst aspect of the business. I did set it up as a legitimate company, kind of wish I hadn't and just done it on the side. Yeah, it's a nightmare just kind of keeping track of transactions, especially ones if you're handling multiple currencies. The accounting was a nightmare. And, you know, it wasn't a tax issue or anything like that. You just have to keep records. And Singapore is one of the best places to start and, you know, manage a business. And I found an absolute administrative headache. So, yeah, big warning for anyone looking to do that. It's fun to get started with a new business, but there is the admin.
Are you on a Graphene OS phone these days?
No, I'm on a Calyx OS phone. Graphene, how can I put it? Like, bit of a kind of rabbit hole in itself. But Graphene, I think, is a, you know, there's nothing wrong with the operating system at all. I wasn't hugely comfortable with the lead dev, but he's moved on to other things, or certainly not kind of being running the project in the same way. My big issue is actually usability on Graphene. For right or wrong reasons, I was pretty dependent on notifications and some of the kind of compatibility. And Calyx OS's solution to that, using MicroG, was actually, I thought, was a pretty elegant solution. It was fine from my perspective, from a security and privacy aspect. And so it was kind of an easy way of running the phone without having all the Google spyware on. I've kind of personally found a lot of the Graphene users would end up storing even a kind of contained Google Play Store anyway to make up for what it was lacking. And for me, that seemed a bit kind of redundant, going to all the hassle doing Graphene and then putting up a kind of limited Play Store. I really just wanted to avoid that tool. So Calyx, to be honest, has been actually absolutely fine for me.
Say a little bit more about that, because a lot of people they're looking for a privacy phone, by which they mean they want at least the operating system stripped, de-Googled. And so they might go into Graphene OS, but then, hey, there are downsides to not having some of those Google services. People want, obviously, they want notifications for messages they get. They might want to be able to easily use apps like Waze, like Uber, whatever. What are the things that people cannot do with GrapheneOS that Calyx makes much simpler?
Yeah, so I think the main thing for me was notifications. It's been a while since I've used Graphene, so I might be a bit out of date. Sometimes you'd find like a dependency in certain apps, and there is a good website. I can't remember that off the top of my head now, but some apps will look for an existence of a Google Play services, and without that, they won't run at all, or you'll get some kind of odd errors. The other thing as well with Graphene, it's not so pronounced on the newer models of Pixels, but it was an issue when I was using it, was that the performance suffered as well, particularly with like, say, multitasking. So if you're moving, say, between open browser, maybe you've got like an instant swap exchange you're doing, and you go from that to the wallet, you might find that your cache kind of clears and you lose the browser storage because, you know, Graphene is kind of quite aggressively managing memory. But these days, I'd actually say there's very little difference between the two in terms of usability. Obviously, there's quite a lot of difference in terms of some of the security and the privacy features between the two, so I wouldn't suggest that. But in terms of usability now, I think really that it shouldn't really drive an individual one way or the other too much. They could try with both and see, for some important apps, what suits for them. Nowadays, it is a lot better. But I'd say kind of notifications was the main problem. And I think, as you say, kind of Google Maps. But then there will be things like, I don't drive in Singapore, but I think Android Auto, for example, wouldn't work on either. So you have still got some friction with any of these de-Googled devices, so to say.
So micro G is one of the big differences between Calyx and Graphene. What is micro G doing for you using Calyx OS?
Yeah, sure. So I think kind of, if I recall correctly, micro G is almost like operating as like a kind of spoofing mechanism. So it kind of includes a piece of code there that kind of says, I am Google Play Services without actually being Google Play Services present on the device. And then there's some other aspects, and this may be particular to Calyx OS's implementation rather than other uses of Google of micro G, but it'll be doing things like, when there's a location request, for example, routing it to a provider like, say, Mozilla, which is a bit more privacy preserving than sending it to, say, Google. So there's a kind of a few different aspects there. The micro G, and I think the kind of the issue that the Graphene OS devs had with it was the nature of the privilege that particular aspect of the software had on the Android operating system, and they felt it was a kind of a bit of a security risk. From my perspective, there was certainly no kind of practical security risk, and it's worth checking out the documentation on the Micro G website. But when you look at it, you can actually see it's being deployed in quite a careful way there. Whereas, again, some of it's to do with the projects and the different priorities. Calyx is designed to be a kind of general privacy phone. It's not a security project, but of course you get a very secure device when you use something like a Pixel by default anyway, and by using the latest Android operating system. Whereas Graphene is very much a security-oriented project, and obviously privacy is an important part, but they will sacrifice some of the usability for where they think they can gain security.
New topic here, the Silent Link admin is going on a crusade right now to get people off of Telegram, and Silent Link being a phone service where you can register for, phone service without any KYC, and you can do it in Monero, Bitcoin, and Lightning. And his point is that Telegram is obviously does not have privacy features built into it. He thinks it's a honeypot of the Russian government. But either way, it is the case that you have these communities on Telegram, which is where a lot of the kind of rebellious people are, but it's clearly not a service, an app that has privacy at heart, even often when you are doing kind of person-to-person conversations. Do you see any problems with Telegram being the central spot where a lot of people talk kind of radically about Bitcoin, Monero, et cetera?
Yeah, I think it is a problem. I would answer the question initially as saying, treat Telegram like social media. Yes. And treat it like a kind of public space rather than a messenger. But like all social media, it's quite a natural progression to move from maybe a group chat and then have a one-to-one message with someone. And because it's such a you know, it's a lovely app to use. It's fun. It's got stickers. It's got GIFs. There's now kind of always to discover channels and other content, which doesn't have the censorship that you see in other social media equivalents. You're going to kind of end up using it as a kind of default messenger and potentially getting too comfortable. So I think it is a problem. I think, though, is that it would be a mistake to come off it entirely, just because I think it's a very powerful social media app for passing uncensored communication. You know, public as well, because of the sheer reach it has and the performance capabilities the app it has in terms of speed and redundancy and being up all the time. Being a good UX is important. And I think as well is that Telegram has actually had, whilst it has got security issues, there are some basic privacy aspects to it that are useful. You know, if you're obviously you're kind of OPSEC focused, you disregard, but they shouldn't be disregarded for an ordinary user. And just as an example is, it may be that your phone number is not private to Telegram, but the fact that you can hide your phone number to your peers is a useful privacy gain. It may not be great if you're attending a demo and that Telegram user profile that you've got, you're being targeted by a government, obviously. It's not going to kind of give you that kind of protection. But if you're worried about, say, posting on a topic which needs to be posted about and discussed publicly, and you use a NIM and you don't make your mobile phone number public, then you've actually got a pretty robust way of making your voice heard in a censorship-resistant manner and in a private manner, just because you can't be exposed, you know, lose your job, be otherwise pressured, etc. And from that, I think it has a purpose. It's just, you know, just needs to be used in the right circumstances.
I think what you said encapsulates my views entirely as well. One more quick phone question. I understand that phones are, especially the ones that we're talking about, Graphene OS, et cetera, are more secure because there's sandboxing and all these kinds of good things, more secure than using your average desktop where permissions are more readily granted. But my concern with phones has always been that they have baked in GPS units because that is their purpose, right? They have baked in GPS units and they also have baked in chips, which connects them with towers. And sure, you can try to muffle those and turn those off, et cetera, but that's what they're designed for. And my location is a prized piece of information. And so I'm always concerned anytime I'm doing anything on a phone, an app, et cetera, if it will have access to that GPS location. And that's why I always prefer computers rather than phones. Your thoughts on that?
No, I think you're spot on. I think there's a couple of things. You know, I tried to make it clear even with Mushi. So I used to get kind of some interesting questions, you know, through the email contact page, like, hey, I want a super secret phone. Can you kind of customize this for me? Can you set this up before you send it, etc.? So I get these type of queries. One of the things I try and make clear to people is that phones aren't that private, and they're certainly not private when it comes to location. And of course, one of the things that you can kind of quickly realize about a phone is if you take the SIM card out, you can still make an emergency services call. So there's still a capability to connect to local phone masts and triangulate a position there. So you've always got a kind of problem there. You can obviously cycle through SIM cards. You can do all these things. But ultimately, if comes down to threat model. If someone is trying to actually, you know, find out where you are and your location is a problem, then you really just shouldn't use a phone. And that's actually, you know, really the message there, which is a pretty tough pill to swallow if you really like your phone and you like the convenience of it. But that is kind of really the reality. And Graphene won't change that. At all. That being said, there is a kind of, you know, one other kind of, you know, happy medium, I suppose. If you're looking for something that's, say, a private messenger, and that you are very concerned about location, you're very concerned about privacy and your security, but you also want something usable. One kind of decent option to go for is the Pixel Fold, the tablet devices Google have released. And you can actually install Graphene, and the latest I checked as well, there's certainly a beta version, and I'm sure it's kind of now fully in production, of Calyx OS as well. And so you can actually install a mobile phone, effectively a mobile phone operating system, and if you want a kind of secure hardened one like Graphene, you can install that to a Pixel, and that's not going to come with antenna and, you know, the kind of the phone home aspect that a mobile phone will have, but it's going to give you some of that benefit of and a more isolated environment that's not always as open as some desktops, and still kind of you can really kind of lock that down quite well. And you could have like a tablet, you could use an app like say Threema, or there's another popular one now, Session, for example, where by default your communications are end-to-end encrypted. You don't associate a phone number to them. You can pretty quickly connect over Tor or a VPN, and you can do all that. And my advice would be is don't even use your own Wi-Fi. You could just Wi-Fi hotspot, or if you really need to be mobile, you could actually buy a separate Wi-Fi type device and use like say a silent link SIM in that. And that way you've kind of got a bit of a break between your actual mobile phone device, or your mobile device rather, like the tablet, and your actual router that you're kind of querying through. And so it is actually quite within reach of an ordinary user to get a really extreme level of security and privacy, which can still remain in a very easy to use way. We're just talking about standard apps here, no real configuration. You just have to have the discipline to continue to use it and then not use that device, say, to kind of browse random sites, etc. If you were doing a particularly high risk communications, you would use that as a dedicated device for whatever you're doing, and then when you're finished with it, turn it off and leave it off, and then only switch it back on when you use it. So I think there's a lot of scope for using these devices for specific purposes. And then if you get used to it and you can use it as a default device, then great. That's certainly not a reason for you to kind of just give up entirely on the whole achieving privacy.
I guess I had assumed that even a Pixel tablet has the built-in GPS chips. I thought iPads did. I guess I was just making that assumption.
I think a Pixel will have a GPS tab from recollection. I haven't got one, so but you're not going to have the mobile phone antenna, which is where a lot of the triangulation of your position will occur without you having the ability to turn that off within the controls. At least with, say, like Graphene or any Android distribution, you can switch off a GPS location in the settings, and that's not going to get overridden. And you can trust, you can trust the source code there to not be switching that on without your knowledge. But at least you're not going to have to worry about a kind of passive scanning of phone masts for emergency services, because you actually literally haven't got a cellular device inside the iPad or Google Pixel tablet.
One more question before we get to the good stuff, Monero and Bitcoin. You're internationally minded. You still have your feet firmly planted in traditional finance. Any advice for people who want to still be in traditional finance? Apps like Revolut, like Wise, are there any tools that make your life easier that you would recommend that, maybe if not privacy, then give you convenience or more freedom in your day-to-day banking that you'd be willing to talk about?
Yeah, I just say, if you can stomach going through the KYC, etc., I think having a few redundant bank accounts is useful. You never know when one might get closed down for inactivity or for making a transaction that is viewed as questionable. I've had accounts with Revolut. I think last I checked, Wise potentially even has better rates than Revolut. So I've used those apps a hell of a lot, and will use. I've even kind of kept a couple of redundant charge card type apps that you kind of top up with crypto below a certain level before you have to kind of KYC. So I think kind of having all of those is just useful as kind of backup. Even if you don't have to use them all the time, it's certainly useful. Unless you're really kind of sure about it, I wouldn't advise kind of closing down all your accounts. Obviously, it depends on circumstances.
Agreed.
But I think leaving that kind of available to you so you can dip in when you need is a lifesaver. I've even kept, it kind of sounds funny, but I've kept my same UK SIM card going from the 15 years I've left the UK, and I like that for the convenience of people knowing who I am if I call. But obviously, if I need to, I've used kind of services like the eSIM, the silent link, and have used that as well. So I think kind of range of services, cards, credit lines available to you for when you need are all absolutely crucial.
There's also a benefit to having aged accounts. They are deemed more trustworthy. So don't get rid of things just for the sake of getting rid of them. They will come in handy down the line.
Yeah, that's actually a really interesting thing about the aged accounts. So, people kind of love to talk about kind of the social credit scores that are coming. But, you know, in a lot of countries, these have existed for a long time and really affect you in ways that you don't necessarily always know. You know, I've even checked my credit scores in the UK. And what's kind of funny is that I've got a near on perfect credit score, except for the fact that my credit card can only borrow so much money. It's not as much as it should be. And so you can actually get fined for a credit score with not being able to borrow so much money because you keep on paying your credit card off every month or you don't spend enough on it. So, you know, some kind of level activity on these things when you want to have the ability to be able to spend normally, as so to say, I definitely kind of advise, but you've got to balance that out with making sure you've got the kind of comfort with transacting in cash, especially with Bitcoin and Monero and all these things online, and just really kind of go through the motions there to make sure that you're kind of not trapped out of either realm, so to speak.
No, absolutely agree. But of course, Max, if you don't borrow lots of money, how could you ever be a trustworthy person to lend to?
Exactly.
Let's move on to Bitcoin Monero now. But before we get there, just curious your thoughts. There are other privacy coins out there, things like Pirate Chain, WowNero.
I suppose nowadays I feel that there's enough to keep me busy just following things in the Bitcoin and Monero space. So I would actually say is I certainly wouldn't automatically dismiss them, but just my level of bandwidth to say investigate all of these has been limited. So, but I did use, I didn't ever use Zcash directly, I don't think, but I used, funnily enough, when all the forks were coming out in Bitcoin, like Bitcoin Gold and Cash and all that, it's often forgotten about that there was a coin called Bitcoin Private, which was like a kind of weird mix of a Bitcoin fork and some other fork of another coin. I can't remember off the top of my head, but that actually was like a fork of the Zcash code base. And so I kind of did an early Zcash style shielded transaction. Completely confidential amounts, completely kind of obscured transaction graph. But I remember back then it took me 4 minutes on the laptop I had, which was not particularly well powered. It was just a MacBook Air. It took me 4 minutes to make a transaction. So, I have tried some of these other coins, and it was kind of amusing seeing some of the approaches that some of the other coins took. And obviously, since then, Zcash has optimized substantially. And now you can do these transactions on mobile without a lot less computational power. But what I would say, though, is things like WowNero, I've never used, but I would just see that as kind of like almost like a kind of testnet type thing for Monero. So I've never really looked too deeply into that. I've kind of been aware of Firo, but I haven't played with it directly. I was very interested in the Mimblewimble protocols when they got announced, but was just a bit disappointed with the way that they launched the coin, which especially the issuance rate. So I think Grin was one of the coins. There was Beam, I think, was another Mimblewimble coin. But I thought they were really interesting projects. Certainly kind of Grin started off in a really interesting way, kind of a similar launch to Monero and Bitcoin. But, I think they were doing like an issuance of one Grin per second. And so it really kind of failed to get the interest of people as a bootstrap mechanism. And I think as well, there were some serious criticisms on some of the privacy benefits they had. So I've kind of erred towards just using Monero and privacy enhanced Bitcoin transactions that I'm very confident with, because I feel they've been kind of, I've had the time to research them, and I've also had the chance to transact with them. And because this is the other problem is, if I can't find like a merchant that I can spend these coins at, then a lot of the use cases become a bit redundant. Like, it's kind of hard to really see how they can be useful privacy coin if they fail to kind of get past that chicken and egg scenario of being used enough to be trusted. They have to be actually used to even be kind of trusted and get any kind of real anonymity set in the first place. So I've been pretty skeptical of anything new coming along since Monero got like such a foothold in the darknet markets and became like a default payment mechanism, because now I see that that's an incredibly hard network effect to shift. And so, from my kind of comfort level with privacy, I will really only concentrate on Monero and Bitcoin now.
Monero. I'd just like to get a sense of the ways that people are using Monero. So if you feel comfortable, just curious what's your preferred wallets, swap services, marketplaces, any kind of resources, just to give a sense of how you use Monero.
Monero kind of was something I was interested in from kind of really the early days. I think I kind of started off using that web-based wallet, MyMonero, and then actually quickly moved to the core wallet because I found that quite a good usable wallet on the desktop. Since then, you know, being a kind of long-term iOS user, there wasn't much choice there for the wallets. And so when I moved to Android, my default wallet there has been Monero Joe, that one, largely just because I'm comfortable with it and I find it easy to use. I have played around with, I think it's called MySu now, done by the Pox developer, that has some coin control, very much based around Tor, which, you know, depending on how good your connectivity is to Tor, your mileage may vary according to the app, but that's been a great wallet to use. In fact, I'd say you're spoilt for choice there. I haven't had a chance to play around with the Anon or Nero apps, but that is something I definitely like to kind of work on next. Just the reality is that actually with Monero Joe, I've kind of had what I've needed to anyway. It hasn't got full coin control, but I've over the years had slight workarounds to dealing with the kind of the coin control aspects of Monero when they're required, which isn't much. I've got subaddresses. I've got Tor connectivity if I need it. I can connect to my own local Monero node if I need it. It's a pretty fast sync. You know, it's a reliable app. So I've moved through a few wallets, but ultimately I feel no great push to change wallets or to move to something else because just the general wallet space is good and it's backed up with a pretty robust protocol. In terms of using Monero, just something easy. I use it often for my VPN purchases and for server purchases as well. So I use VPN services like Mulvad, and I've also used iVPN as well. And it's particularly been great when, you know, fees go very high on Bitcoin. I'll just typically spend from my Monero stack rather than using Bitcoin. And then the other thing I've used Monero for, which is probably actually kind of some of my biggest uses of Monero, was kind of using it, and I think it's been talked about a lot, but using it for change from Whirlpool coin joins on Bitcoin. So kind of taking those odd amounts that if they were included with other transactions would expose a lot of your kind of previous transactional history. I'll just do a swap service into Monero, keep a bit of Monero, and as and when I'll just convert that back into Bitcoin if I need to. And I've used a range of different swap services for that. I use Fixed Float because of its ease. You know, again, if you're kind of more concerned about network privacy and you want to access over Tor, I found Majestic, the market there, a really reliable service there with good support. Again, it's going to be, you know, briefly custodial for the duration of the swap, and doing a little bit of testing on the Samurai Monero Atomic Swap product there. So I'm an early beta tester of that. So kind of that's for me is kind of probably one of the more interesting use cases of Monero there, kind of making up for the weakest aspect of Whirlpool, which is the kind of the odd amount change from a coin join there.
Speaking of Monero and some of these large global cities, particularly as you head eastward, this is from CoinDesk. They say that in Dubai, the issuance of and all activities related to anonymity-enhancing cryptocurrencies such as Monero are prohibited under new laws. So Monero is completely banned, it seems to me, in Dubai.
So yeah, I haven't even been to Dubai yet. I had heard about some of that. We've seen, you know, in Asia, delistings, particularly on the exchanges, from more than just Monero. So even Litecoin got delisted from some of like the Korean exchanges after the introduction of the Mimblewimble sidechain there, or MWeb, I think it's called. And I kind of think that this trend will continue. It's only a matter of time before these protocols get cut off entirely. I think there's a positive side to this in the fact that it will push these markets these currencies into being used in a kind of more bizarre type market, peer-to-peer, kind of on the street and through the dark net. So there's less chance of corporate capture. And I think they've also been blessed with the time on these grey market exchanges, and in some cases white market exchanges, where, you know, they've served as a way to get, you know, issuance of these coins into the hands of a lot of people that might not have ordinarily got them. I think kind of from a regulatory perspective, there's actually really no reason to be delisting or banning these coins. I've long thought, you know, right from the earliest days of me first getting into Bitcoin, that really an e-cash should be just treated like cash by any kind of bank. That's not been the way regulated institutions have gone. But certainly from kind of my logical perspective is that if you can go to a bank and deposit, you know, $5,000 worth of cash with no history, there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to do that with, you know, something like Monero and just be kind of, you know, do the KYC of the customers once they kind of get into the banking system and on the way out. But once it goes out, treat that as you do cash. I think, you know, the world we're in now, the compass has moved and for that no longer to be tolerable. So I don't see that adjusting anytime soon. And I think that those delistings will continue. In terms of, you know, what I see as those kind of more street level market, particularly in Singapore, there's a fairly active peer-to-peer market actually organized on Telegram, where people trade, you know, anything. I've seen trades of, you know, $1,000, $5,000, $10,000 and to $100,000, $200,000, $500,000, you know, even millions of dollars. Face-to-face meetups are done on Telegram. I think, you know, very unusual to see people ask for Monero there. And in fact, even Bitcoin is not all that common. And a lot of it is cash to Tether or USDC. And so I think, you know, where you're going to see a lot of these gateways effectively either in cash or in some of the kind of the more kind of heavy regulated institutions is they'll move from straight fiat to kind of a fiat-friendly crypto, where that's a kind of a highly regulated Bitcoin or a stable coin. And then once people have found their way of withdrawing it into their own custody, then it's kind of, you know, then they'll do the moves that they need to with unidentified counterparts, preferably in a kind of more trustless manner and, you know, with a lot of network and security privacy for a kind of circular economy outside of that. So I think there'll always be a way to do that. It's just that the methods of that are going to potentially change, you know, here and there according to the different jurisdictions.
Continuing on with Monero, a question here that is sure to offend both Bitcoiners and Monero users. You hold a view that Monero can be the layer two of Bitcoin.
I'll admit it's a little disingenuous, as it's obviously a completely different free-floating token. And what I kind of possibly kind of like to more describe it as is it's like my layer two. People have to be honest, firstly, is that layers to Bitcoin are a kind of not particularly robust term anyway. You know, you take something like Lightning, which is widely considered as a layer two, and it is Bitcoin to all intents and purposes. It's, you know, it's a multi-sig set of channels, it's Bitcoin being used, and it's kind of largely non-custodial, even if you're kind of going into kind of a joint custody arrangement as part of a channel. But it's not Bitcoin when it comes to the actual payment network. It's a different invoicing system, it's a different trade-off, it's a different UX. And then you've got other separate blockchains entirely like Liquid that are backed by Bitcoin that people try and also sell as a layer two. So if those things can be described as a layer two, I feel that you can get away with kind of describing the same for Monero. So part of that kind of comment from me is partly in response to the marketing around some of the other solutions in relation to Bitcoin. But kind of specifically what I mean when I term it as a kind of as a layer two is that I use it for transactions that are less sizable in terms of volume. I could do it for, you know, I'd be comfortable making Monero transactions to a size that's kind of far less than I would be on Bitcoin due to the volatility, due to the kind of the available counterparts. And if I was, for example, to trade it, I could be assured of a lot greater depth and better execution price going in and out of Bitcoin than I could be on something like Monero, just because Bitcoin's so much more integrated into the kind of the regulated exchanges overall. I also feel that it's kind of made different trade-offs with a variable block size that mean that it doesn't really share the same externality kind of issues that externality costs that Bitcoin has. So, you know, by its nature, you know, being a cheaper per unit than Bitcoin, the mining fees are lower, so you can use it for kind of lower value transactions. And I think it's also, for me, serves me as a layer two in the fact that I feel I can go in and out of Monero from Bitcoin and not actually cause myself a privacy liability on Bitcoin, which I certainly feel if I was to kind of go in and out of Liquid or go in and out of Lightning, I can actually kind of endanger my privacy on Bitcoin. Whereas I certainly don't feel that with Monero because my privacy upgrades itself when it goes onto Monero, and I'm pretty confident there.
Do you see a problem with Monero in that each transaction takes up a good few bytes compared to Bitcoin? And if there are a sizable amount of people who start using Monero, that blockchain could become pretty large pretty quickly and it might not be easy for people to have a full node on their computer. Do you foresee that as a problem?
I think it potentially could be, but I suppose I would qualify that with a couple of points. I think it's a valid kind of concern and criticism of Monero, but one thing I'm not concerned about is the storage cost.
and the storage kind of capabilities for running a full node. There are pruning capabilities on Monero, so you can reduce the data set quite substantially. Not quite to the level you can prune with Bitcoin due to the nature of the UTXOs or just the TXOs on Monero. It's probably more correct to say, as you're not aware if they're unspent or spent. But I suppose I would have more of a concern, although I haven't done the numbers on this, as to just kind of what the bandwidth demand would be. And by that I mean is, you know, if blocks are propagating of a kind of much larger size, you know, if you're running a node behind Tor and you can't keep up with that, that was always my concern, for example, you know, during the block size wars for Bitcoin in 2017, really. It wasn't so much, you know, that nodes would be so large that only data centers could be able to handle them. It was more about kind of the bandwidth demand. I think, though, as well is that I think some of the block size debate and all the concerns around it have been oversimplified in the fact that people are very wary of large blocks. And it's almost a bit of a taboo to speak as a Bitcoiner about being in favor of larger blocks. And personally speaking, I don't see a huge issue of moving to larger blocks even in Bitcoin. You know, I wouldn't rule it out. But I think for me, as it's the same case as it was in 2017, the issue isn't really whether you go to block of a certain size. It's kind of how do you achieve consensus for that? And, you know, is it another fixed amount? You know, do you try and move to a variable amount? And all of those have kind of quite significant trade-offs. So I like the fact that Monero actually offers a different set of trade-offs without replicating Bitcoin. And if it fails or kind of leads to a kind of huge amount of issues because of that, then the great thing is if you're treating it as a layer two to your Bitcoin, you can always kind of move your assets from one chain to another accordingly in advance of these things becoming issues as they present themselves. So I think that's kind of a very useful real-time demonstration of the different trade-offs of the chain. And I'm quite no strong opinion either way. I'm kind of happy to see how that ends up for both chains, really, the decisions that were made on the architecture.
One more Monero question. You're very informed about all of the topics that you speak about. Do you have any people you would recommend for people who want to learn more about the stuff happening with Monero specifically?
Yeah, so probably one of the most people I follow for a lot of information on Monero particularly is the pseudonymous developer known as Pokst. That's P-O-K-K-S-T. He's actually doing the work for Samurai for the atomic swaps for Bitcoin and Monero. And he's also built, as I mentioned before, his Maisu Monero wallet himself. So he's built scripts for kind of, you know, looking at your own anonymity set on Monero. So I find him really, really useful. Goes without saying, Fluffy Pony is a great follow. His talks he's done on confidential transactions and some of the properties of Monero are absolutely fantastic. There's another couple I could recommend as well on Monero. Fortunately, he's not on Twitter anymore, but I used to enjoy Howard Chu, who was behind the RandomX. I did a lot of the work on the RandomX algorithm, a bit of a statist, but, you know, very good for kind of following, kind of getting the technical understanding of Monero and kind of getting a good view on that. And also kind of one of the nice things about Pokst, I would certainly say, is that, you know, he develops on Bitcoin. He's got experience of Bitcoin Cash. And so he's kind of seen some of the scaling work that's been done on the BCH chain. I don't use BCH. I think I've used it once. But I think that gives him like an extra perspective outside of an ordinary kind of far more focused developer. The Monerujo Telegram group is good. I went into it briefly and came out just because I didn't have the time to follow it, but the Anonero group will have a very kind of core, keen set of users in there that will be, you know, great to follow. That being said, there's kind of more generic groups like the Sovereign Bitcoiner, for example, where you'll just get kind of very practical uses and a lot of people in there that will use both Bitcoin and Monero and will be happy to kind of share their experiences on both there.
Well, how about a rapid fire session? What computer operating system do you use these days?
Quite happy to admit, I use Mac OS completely for the convenience and backup there. But for my Bitcoin node, I actually use Pop OS. But actually, if I was to redo that again, I'd probably just use Debian for the stability.
If you could snap your fingers and Bitcoin has confidential transactions, no more surveillance of the blockchain, would you do it?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, 100%. In fact, that's something I definitely feel that should be pushed.
How much of your browsing happens on the Tor browser? What percent?
Oh, I'd say only 5-10% at tops. Most of my browsing would happen on a Brave browser behind a VPN, and even that, there'll be a whole bunch of services that I'll still have to switch off the VPN to access.
Preferred two-factor authentication?
I use two. So I have a small, just because of the usability, a small two-factor app on macOS called OTP Auth. I also use Aegis Authenticator on Android, which is a fantastic authenticator. Just unfortunately doesn't have a good backup or an easy backup capability, because I would love to back up my authenticator codes to the cloud. I know a lot of people don't, but I do.
What private messengers do you use?
Predominantly Signal and Threema. Those are my main ones. I should try Session again. I didn't because of performance and the lack of kind of groups there, but those are my primary private messengers.
What is one weird privacy thing that you do in your life that you doubt many others do?
For me, backups are absolutely mission critical. So I will use software to back up my entire operating system for both mobile OS and desktop OS, and have that fully encrypted and on the cloud. I can't stand the idea of losing devices and then not having access to them. So I'm quite kind of sentimental on that, and quite careful about ensuring that there's always backups and I've always got redundancy, and they're always done completely end-to-end encrypted.
Which single person on Twitter gets the most attention from you in terms of abuse?
Trouble is I get blocked by most of them now. I suppose, to be honest, if I'm probably going to be fair, probably poor old Stefan Lavera, because he's too friendly and too diplomatic to ever kind of let things escalate to get blocked. I think we're kind of in a good position there of being kind of quite opposing on a number of what would be seen as outsiders as small differences, but actually will be for us opposing sides. But he's always taken it in kind of good faith there. So. Kind of the other kind of people I would mention, and certainly it's not ones I would give abuse to, I can't really pronounce his name. Is it Reindal? The other one is, I think the name, again, a lot of these people have abbreviations on Twitter, but Reardon Code, who I worked with a bit at BitGo, Brandon Black, his name is. He's done a lot of talk on CTV, of where I differ quite a lot in my opinion there, and Rob Hamilton. But those guys are great people to follow. I don't agree with a lot of their takes on direction that Bitcoin Core is going in and the direction they want to take it in, but they always take my criticism in very good spirits and are quite happy to explain their kind of arguments well. So I highly recommend them as follows and not as people that certainly sing from my hymn sheet.
Let's move into Bitcoin now and just start with a very easy question, which is, what gives Bitcoin a value?
I think a lot of people really come up with some pretty imaginary answers to it. My answer is going to be really boring. I think the value of Bitcoin is just simply as a token to make an immutable change to a database. That might sound crazy that, 100 million of those units are currently worth $43,500, but that is all the value of Bitcoin. It's just to make an immutable change to a database. The fact that it's a token and the fact that it can be moved from one person one individual to another or on that transactional database ledger adds to the value there and is the reason why there is a price to it. But that is really, for me, the only value to Bitcoin. And that is not a trivial thing at all, because until Bitcoin was created, there was always, someone, in charge of a ledger or kind of some kind of committee or something. And there wasn't the updates to ledger done in the way of, proof of work mining. And for me, that's really the value of it. And that's kind of the correct frame of mind to have when you're looking at Bitcoin.
What happened to the Sovereign Bitcoiner website?
I think it was just failed to renew. So the fella that was administering that kind of got into, I think we kind of see this quite often, they kind of go through a rabbit hole of discovering all a bunch of open source software, interesting kind of ways to quickly deploy a website, and then either lost interest or, personal issues took over, and then, just failed to renew the website, lost interest, and kind of left it alone. I had a mixed relationship with that administrator, but, he's an interesting character, but we got on towards the end very, very well.
Before BIP39, which gave us seed phrases, how did people tend to deal with or back up their private keys?
I would believe that would be largely people using the wallet.dat file that would have come through from Bitcoin Core. There may have been some other schemes around, but in truth, when I first started using Bitcoin, BIP39 was already well established as a standard. So there would have been BIP32 potentially, I think. I'd have to double check on kind of the timings as well. But yeah, largely it'd be either a single private key and a deterministic set of keys from there, or literally a small kind of database of randomly generated keys, and you'd have to just back that up and be sure that you're kind of keeping that saved and not lost.
What is Taproot and why is it such an important update to Bitcoin?
So actually, I'm trying to think now. So Taproot, very much from my perspective, actually I'll answer it completely from my perspective, because I'm not going to give you a great answer as to why it's important for Bitcoin, because it hasn't been that important for me for Bitcoin. I think there was certainly some benefits in the anonymity of the script. When you use a script for an address type in Bitcoin, say like a multi-sig script, where you can have two or three keys being involved in the spending conditions for that spend, you could also have three or five. With something like Taproot, there's multiple types of scripts here. You can actually obfuscate the actual script that's used to sign for that transaction. So you kind of get some privacy benefit there. It's a new address encoding, and so a slightly different format. And I believe it was seen as a foundational upgrade for further upgrades to be done for scripting on Bitcoin. It's also important in my opinion, in terms of some of the damage it has done to the privacy on Bitcoin. So whilst it offers some anonymity in the actual spending conditions on the script, by being a new script type, it actually stands out on chain. And by that, I mean, if you have a wallet that is an old BEC32 script address, and you spend with a transaction from that, and then you spend to a Taproot address, and then the change goes back to a wallet that's also BEC32 type in your wallet, it's going to be pretty clear that who the entities are there. You're making a transaction to a different wallet, and then the change is quite clearly identifiable as change, because it's of the same script type as you. And so Taproot brought in a new script type, and crucially, there was only really an incentive to move to it for multi-sig type users because of one of the privacy on the script, also some cost savings. But actually, as a single sig user, and you'll find this is a bit of a contentious point, but it's actually arguably more expensive for a single sig user to move to Taproot than the current BEC32 pay-to. My memory's gone there for a brief bit, but yeah, the kind of the BEC32 format for those type of addresses, it's actually a bit more expensive. So there's no real incentive for a lot of users to move to that. And I think kind of what's interesting as well is there's also a bit of a lack of standards. So for things like wallets like Sparrow, for example, which are very ahead of the wallet game, and they offer a whole way of doing many different types of wallets, both single sig and multi-sig across multiple script types, and the wallet supports a lot of hardware devices. As far as I recall, on the latest version, you still don't by default are able to set up a Taproot multi-sig, for example, just because we're still waiting for some standards there.
These are a couple of topics that you want to make sure to cover along similar lines regarding Taproot, multi-sig, and the difference between the core development, the core developers and their plans versus how Bitcoin is actually used. What point did you want to make with that?
I think kind of one of the interesting things with Taproot is if you look at the reasoning behind it, it was certainly seen as an enabler of more efficient, more scalable Lightning channel opens and closures, and to improve the privacy around that. And as Lightning is in itself a multi-sig transaction, also for general multi-sig use cases as well. What's interesting about Taproot is how little uptake, possibly now over 2 years since update, there has actually been of Taproot. And in fact, the only real noticeable uptake has been through the Ordinals protocol, where users embed generic text data using Taproot addresses to actually encode data of a non-transactional aspect into the blockchain. And I think kind of as an interesting point is that multi-sig has obviously been used quite a bit in Bitcoin, and there are some kind of well-known custodians, for example, that use multi-sig. But actually, if you kind of go back to the earliest days of Bitcoin, it was something pushed by, I think, Gavin Anderson. There's a good article on the first P2SH script type that came to Bitcoin because of the concern over people kind of keeping wallets and coins where only one single signature is required to move the assets there. But, you know, since, I would say probably since 2017, 2018, there's been a larger industry move away from multi-sig to multi-party computation. Despite what the core developers have intended for Bitcoin to be used by, the actual largest custodians, pretty much all the exchanges, they are actually going to use MPC addresses, which on chain will look like a single sig address, but actually, for in terms of the spending, resemble a lot of the properties of multi-sig. And so, you know, these enhancements that have come with Taproot, I'm still not really sure what kind of users are going to use these type of transactions, given that a lot of the industry has already moved away to kind of an application level development for solving some of the kind of the problems that Taproot and further kind of enhancements such as CTV are designed to actually achieve.
Another improvement to Bitcoin that is being discussed is covenants, and we have CTV. Could you explain what those are and whether or not you support them?
Actually, kind of mentioning someone I mentioned already before, the Read and Code account on Twitter. He did a recent podcast with Stephen Levera, which I would really recommend everyone to listen to. A couple of, you know, good guys speaking, you know, what they think are kind of the benefits here. And I kind of urge people to listen to it because as a podcast, I disagree with almost everything in it. It's kind of amusing. It really kind of is opposite. You know, firstly, kind of as I understand covenants, and there might be better ways to describe it, but I would kind of describe it as adding kind of an additional set of conditions onto the way that you spend Bitcoin. Bitcoin's got a fairly simple script at the moment. You've got kind of time lock thresholds for signing, and covenants would introduce a number of other different types of thresholds that you could kind of do with, you know, nesting leafs of spending conditions and all sorts adding into the script type. I think for me, kind of taking a step back, what is actually demanding this whole kind of requirement for covenants on Bitcoin? And for me, the real requirement is somewhat disingenuous. A lot of it stems from the fact that everyone that's pushing for this, I would say, and you really, you know, validate this by listening to your own podcasts and following the tweets from people that are the proponents of it and see if this is correct. But at least my kind of impression is that everyone sees this as just merely a way to scale Bitcoin. And they see as a huge problem with Bitcoin now is that the UTXO, the amount that the UTXO set could grow is quite limited. You can only onboard so many users on. And they see as a huge benefit that you could take a single UTXO and using covenants have a lot more individuals on that UTXO with kind of mechanisms to share the ownership and do spending in order to kind of bring more users to Bitcoin. My issue with that is just as an initial reason, is I don't see any pressing reason to onboard more people onto Bitcoin. I don't see the demand yet for more individuals to use Bitcoin. It's being used as an excuse that, say, something like gold, the reason that gold failed as money is that it couldn't get to every individual, and that's why it went into custody, and that there's this kind of choice that users have. If they don't support covenants, then the only kind of way that people are going to onboard to Bitcoin is going to go into custody. Whereas I would challenge that, and I would say, well, it's not that people have a choice to use Bitcoin in a custodial way or use covenants. They can also just simply not use Bitcoin. And Bitcoin is not a mainstream currency. It's not necessarily a mainstream use case. And there's no real indication that people are using Bitcoin at the levels of permissionless transactions where they really need to go above the transactional volume levels that they're using. And as we've seen already, with some of the privacy issues on Bitcoin, some of the users that were using Bitcoin originally for the permissionless cash usage have actually already shifted off Bitcoin and moved on to other blockchains. And Bitcoin has actually lost a user base and has had ground seeded to other competing blockchains such as Monero. And for me, I see that as a bit of a problem for Bitcoin. A couple of things I'd like to set straight. Gold didn't, you can just look around in any country, you go to India, you can go to kind of all sorts of areas. Gold's had a wide distribution. The issue of gold being in the hands of the people isn't because it doesn't scale. It was moved into custody because of the, you mentioned the telegraph and the ability to do settlement in an electronic way. And for people that couldn't afford gold or couldn't afford an amount of gold, they would use also silver to be their bearer instrument and their saving instrument of choice. There is no driving reason why we need to scale Bitcoin up to more users. But there is a huge issue now with the standard privacy aspects on Bitcoin and the lack of core aspects at the protocol level that support privacy. And so the big things that are missing, in my opinion, are signature aggregation, which was spoken about a lot a few years ago and has kind of faded out of interest of the core developers and would actually scale on-chain protocol. We're not talking about shared UTXOs. We just mean, you know, aggregating some of the signatures in a way that we transactions would cost less for kind of more inputs. And of course, adding something like confidential transactions, which would obscure the amounts on chain and giving an enormous benefit to users. Because at the moment, we now have a protocol that's really very, very public by default. And I think that part of the usage that we're seeing in Bitcoin is reflective of how the protocol operates rather than what it was originally intended for. You know, you have this protocol that is by default public, that is by default typically easy for many users to reuse address, display their whole balance. Is it any wonder that users are using that for inscribing artwork, JPEGs, text, and they're using it more for kind of flexing of digital artifacts rather than actually using it as eCash when the protocol actually encourages and provides the incentives for that? If the core developers could get away from the mentality of how can we just onboard more users, or how can we give users more ways to play around with the scripting for what is really not a particularly compelling set of use cases that they've come up with anyway. They actually went back to the kind of the core principles of Bitcoin and said, how can we make this more usable as cash? I think you'd see a different type of usage on Bitcoin and a more empowered set of users as well. And what worries me about covenants isn't certainly anything specific on the covenants that I see as some danger to the network. But what I do see is once covenants are built in, I see challenges such as signature aggregation being even more of a challenge to put in. I've seen no kind of assurance that by putting in these additional things at the protocol level, some of the things I wanted to see, privacy gains and scalability gains at the protocol, maybe less, you know, not less likely to be implemented. And it's almost like when you speak to a core developer, they've actually given up on the whole idea of transactional privacy at Bitcoin. When you speak to them and say, you know, I have a problem where my transactions are typically deterministic unless I use application such as, you know, Sparrow or Samurai with coin joins inbuilt. And even then, you know, it's a far cry from being ideal. The actual answers you get is, well, don't worry, you can use like payment pools, or you can use some other kind of layer two that will be enabled by what we're going to add with covenants at the layer one. And for me, that is just not going to be good enough. There's no guarantee that these layer twos will achieve the network effect, being different payment systems. As we saw with things like Lightning, they had different trade-offs. Trust with the, you know, maybe the need to be online, maybe the assurance that you have on the safety of your funds being embedded in another kind of set of protocol with circumstances. These are being proposed by developers that have got no background in providing holistic privacy schemes where there is demonstrable privacy gained and demonstrable non-sets and a kind of, you know, at all kind of Sybil proof or anything like that. And if actually when you really drive down into this podcast, I think a couple of other revealing things come out, which is that they also talk about the challenge of, well, what happens when you move to a layer two from your layer one? What about that problem of being able to get back to that layer one of Bitcoin? You know, you've done all your transactions in some theoretical payment pool. How do I now kind of move back to, you know, an assured UTXO on Bitcoin? There is no real clear plan for that. So for me, it feels that very much we have core developers looking to add attributes to the Bitcoin protocol that are interesting to them, that offer a lot of potential use cases, but there's no real actual industry demand. There's no real user demand. And that the last big upgrade that was done at the protocol level didn't result in the use that was expected, but resulted in some other completely out of left field use with the Ordinals protocol. And so for me, it's a very kind of worrying direction that the core development team have taken. And although I'm quite realistic on my ability to influence that, I certainly won't hold back in saying that that's where I see the trajectory, and I don't think it's a good one.
That is a very anti-establishment take that I'm very happy to help to publicize. As we start to wind down here, I'm told that you are a great experimenter with the various wallets out there. I'm sure you use Samurai Wallet and Sparrow Wallet. Are there any wallets that really interest you?
So Sparrow and Samurai, obviously the wallets I use kind of more day-to-day, as well as some of the Monero wallets I mentioned as well. I definitely give a big shout out to the Envoy wallet that's designed to be used in conjunction with the Foundation Passport device. it's a really kind of excellent wallet. And I think the work that was done on coin control there, actually kind of handling the UTXOs and being able to select which ones for a spend, it's been done in a really excellent way on the user interface. So, you know, I really, you know, enjoy using that wallet. And, you know, it connects straight to kind of an Electrum server. So if you're like me, and you might hate to admit it, but you hate having to rely on Tor for the network connectivity to a server, you can use that with your own kind of self-hosted VPN and kind of connect into a server off your own computer and have a very fast and reliable connection as well. I also, for the iOS users, I would also recommend Stack Wallet, which can support both Bitcoin, Monero. The more fully fledged wallet supports a number of other coins, but certainly as a kind of, there's a Stack Duo that supports Bitcoin and Monero. There's some basic kind of Paynim integration there. And, you know, again, very kind of nice user interface, easy to use, and it's certainly a kind of a good wallet to set up your friends and family with as well, if they're not quite ready to take the dip with a more advanced user wallet.
With the Samurai wallet, it seems like atomic swaps between Monero and Bitcoin within the wallet are on the horizon. How, maybe you could just briefly explain how atomic swaps work and whether or not you see that as a game changer.
Yeah, so very kind of high level on the atomic swaps. There's a couple of white papers out there. I think the one that the Samurai one is based off of would be what's known as the Comet network. They've done the white paper and the initial design there. You'll also find an example of that on the website. I think it's unstoppableswap.net, which started off as a web interface, and then they've actually got a downloadable tool. So I think it's pretty much the same mechanism as that, with an improved Tor library that Pox is working on and some other enhancements there. As I understand, a bit of at the edge of my knowledge, but it's a 2 of 2 multi-sig with a time lock, I think. I think it's 2 of 2, could be 2 of 3, but I think it's 2 of 2 that your Bitcoin goes into. And then on the Monero side, there's a similar mechanism, although interestingly, Monero doesn't have the same kind of multi-sig scripting that Bitcoin has. So that scripting happens off-chain. And then effectively, both coins are locked into a kind of contract with a time lock. And then once the conditions of the spend are fulfilled and the users have agreed, they'll both co-sign the transactions, and simultaneously the transactions will be broadcast to each of the users. And there'll be a kind of, there'll be a kind of certain periods of lockups based on confirmations as to when they can be done. Super, super high level. It's actually a kind of pretty complex set of steps to go through. But that's kind of largely what's happening. And the real takeaways from that are that the people that are involved in the swap can't walk away with both coins from that. Either the swap is successful and both users walk away with the coins that they agreed at the trade that they agreed with, or they walk away with nothing. And there's just a kind of a small kind of penalty fee for the user that backs out, if I recall correctly. I think it's a game changer largely because fundamentally it's a really decentralized process. This only requires, you know, a willing buyer and a willing seller of the respective currencies to achieve. Going back to, you know, what we've seen with other protocols that offer, you know, similar type of trustless mechanisms for swapping coins, there can be centralization risks. There's certainly centralization and security risks in bridges and similar type of mechanisms. But the great thing about the swap is that it's a very kind of auditable and clearly non-custodial manner with very little kind of effectively zero trust required in the wallet providers as all. You know, you can run your own node infrastructure when using this, and the whole kind of swap can be done non-custodially. And where I think it's also important is where the big criticism for atomic swaps typically comes is around liquidity and just kind of the available, you know, finding kind of the right buyers and sellers at the price that you want. I think, you know, there's a good opportunity here for market makers to step in and people to take on different amount of risks. So you could find someone, for example, that's hedging on a more centralized solution and taking the counterparty risk and being the opposite side to the trade that you go on, but you still benefit as an individual if you're not comfortable with the counterparty risk, still being able to do the BTC and XMR swaps as you need. And certainly that's as a trading perspective. But for me, kind of the most kind of groundbreaking aspect here is that both protocols should really win out of this. the Whirlpool coin join mechanism is excellent, but the big downside of it is being left with change outputs that aren't of the kind of the equal amount that you end up with from a Whirlpool coin join, and they're quite problematic to handle. You know, you want to get rid of them. You don't want to ever include those with spends elsewhere. And so by swapping them into something like Monero, you don't have to worry about equal output coin joins or anything like that on Monero because of the Ring CT protocol. And then you can, you know, collect as much Monero as you're comfortable with, and then you either use that directly to spend, or you can kind of then swap back into a larger amount of Bitcoin to then maybe coin join on from there. And then really the big win for Monero is that, especially in the kind of the case of the delistings and the potential lack of available avenues for people to acquire Monero, they can, you know, very easily go into a wallet such as, you know, Samurai Wallet, and use Bitcoin that, as we all know, is kind of far more tolerated from a regulatory perspective and has got a huge amount of liquidity, and they can acquire Bitcoin just purely if they wish to for the purposes of getting Monero. And so that'll kind of ensure that there's always a kind of a steady demand for the Monero through an avenue that's very hard for anyone to shut down.
And if Bitcoin in the next 2 to 3 years went in all the worst ways that you can imagine, and it was prohibitively expensive to use the transactions on chain, could you imagine yourself washing your hands of it and walking away?
Actually, no. And so I would say I'm actually fairly, and I think a lot of Bitcoin users are the same as me, I'm fairly relaxed about the fee rates and the expense to transact on Bitcoin. And that's certainly not because of my own personal wealth or my privilege or anything like that. It's just that the fee rates on Bitcoin are never in USD, obviously. They're in a Satoshis per byte. And so I have a wallet with my cold storage, for example, and it has a number of UTXOs. And they're not too many, and they're spread across a number of different ranges. And let's say it gets to $1,000 to transact. Well, that probably means that the fiat value of my Bitcoin has also gone up in a similar way. And I'm not going to mind spending that kind of money from a fiat perspective if the value has gone up. The reality is I hold a wallet that has got a sensible number of UTXOs in sensible sizes and denominations. And so I would always see a kind of a scenario where I'd be spending Bitcoin. I certainly would, though, say is that there would be types of products I might not buy in Bitcoin that I would now shift to Monero. And that has already happened, and it's not necessarily a permanent thing. I don't think, for example, that the fee rates that we're seeing now are going to be persistent necessarily. There's no guarantee that fee rates have to go up in Bitcoin in a Satoshis per byte. We could easily get down to a stage once some of the enthusiasm for ordinals dies out, because our BRC20 tokens, which has been the other kind of craze on Bitcoin at the moment, people on Twitter are getting a bit upset and think there's certain individuals behind it. But you know, if you look at, for example, the Sparrow Wallet Telegram group, it's pretty clear that there's certain regions, such as China, where you've got users that are following a kind of craze or a trend of doing these type of transactions. In my time in Bitcoin, these things come and go. And so, I just kind of see it as a bit of a to and fro. Sometimes I use Monero more, sometimes I use Bitcoin more. But in both cases, both are complementary, and I'm happy to have access to both and feel very lucky to.
And as we close down here, are there any topics pertaining to Samurai, politics of Bitcoin, Monero that we didn't cover that you think would be useful or that you wanted to touch on?
I don't think so much kind of the politics there. I think that was kind of well covered in the previous podcast that you had with Zelko and the intern. I think kind of what I would say kind of in the closing remarks is obviously I've been fairly critical of some of the core development direction. My kind of recommendation here and certainly kind of what I want to reinforce is just because, you know, I see the core development direction heading in on a trajectory that I don't like, I certainly don't feel powerless at all. For me, it's just an indication that I just need to pay less attention to what these folk are building and coming up with. I don't need to worry about the white papers. I don't need to worry about a GitHub gist of a kind of half-baked proposal on what some kind of layer 2 payment protocol look like. I can actually safely ignore it. And I can probably leave my core Bitcoin D software on the version that doesn't even support Taproot yet. And it's still going to happily work. And I'm not going to worry about signaling or kind of arguing about it too much. I'm just going to use the software the way I find most useful at the moment. I'm also somewhat at peace with the idea that I don't have control here, and that, you know, I expect Covenants will be activated. I expect the general transaction graph of Bitcoin to get steadily worse, with the transactions being more traceable and more deterministic, to be far more readable and more so than it is now. But that being said, the anonymity set that I'm in with the transactions that I do are going to be fine, and I'm quite comfortable with the application level tools that are available to do that. I think also is that what I suppose I'm most keen on exploring in the next few years is trying to utilize some of the experience I've had, you know, now working at kind of at wallet companies where there's an enterprise use case, and trying to really think about how that can be applied to tools for the users now, for them to use in a more sovereign way. So I think, you know, kind of alluding to kind of what I mentioned before about, you know, trying to do payroll privately, or, you know, if you're the Canadian truckers and you're trying to raise money, trying to manage your wallet with the tools that you have like Whirlpool, but to do so in a kind of multi-sig type way. I think there's a lot can be done at the application level without having to leverage the tools that are coming at the core level, because they will be inapplicable and you won't be able to use them. And so I think that'll be what's interesting to focus on and where the opportunities are. And there's a kind of chance still to kind of keep Bitcoin relevant in the gray markets and darknet markets too.
This has been Max Tannehill. The only link I really have is Twitter, which also contains his Telegram handle. So that's Max, MaxTannehill. I don't know if there's anywhere else to send people, Max, or is there any way for them to thank you for your time that you've given us?
Best advice is find me in the group chats. Sparrow Wallet and Samurai Wallet are the places I spend my most time. They're the places that you'll get the value out of. Ask questions related to wallets to me. Yeah, obviously feel free to DM if you have to, but I like to see people asking the group chats, because there's always plenty of people just like me that are willing to help and answer questions. Use those wallets, donate to those devs, and don't try not to bother them directly, because they've all got important work to do. So certainly kind of my mission in the spare time that I have is to help keep the Samurai team and help keep Craig Raw undisturbed from the general user questions, so they can carry on and do the coding while the rest of us enthusiasts can just kind of help the rest of us along to use the tools.